Good evening, everyone. My name is Susan Vinette. I have had the extreme pleasure and blessing to have begun organizing what we like to call the Vassar College Bookstore Author Series. Coming from the Bronx, I said ours three times, pretty good. Anyway, we have a very special guest this evening, and it's an honor to be able to say that this is Eamon's second time reading for the series. He was truly one of the first faculty authors, and I think Randy's here was the first, and Nancy's here, she was one of the authors in the series, and it's just been great. I don't want to make this an Irish introduction, but I did reach out to a couple of people for whom Eamon is very important, and it's very clear that he is very important to all of you. Marianne Bruno worked for the college for many years, and she recently graduated. And what's one of the lovely things about Marianne is that not only did she write a book, I think it's right over there, co-authored with Betty Daniels, is that she was an adult learner, as though we all are. But what I found out is that Eamon was Marianne's thesis advisor, and she says, "I was fortunate to have Eamon as a teacher and thesis advisor. To say his classes are popular is putting it mildly. In our poetry seminar, we had to choose a poem or passage and read it out loud. We often instead persuaded Eamon to read so we could enjoy his interpretation of the poet's work in his wonderfully rich brogue." And then I don't see Don Foster here, but he was kind enough to send me paragraphs. And I have to tell you, it's very poetic what he says about Eamon. And maybe I'll wait till later to share all the details of Don's roast, if you will. But it is very clear from the kinds of things that Don mentioned, what we find out is not only who Eamon is, but what poetry does for us. And I remember last year's reading, and I walked away saying, "I feel like my life matters." No, it just matters, all the details. So without anything further from me, please help me welcome Eamon.
That's grand, Susan. Thanks, and thank you all for coming, obviously, and great to see a crowd in a bookshop. It's an unusual sight, I suppose, even here. Anyway, I thought I'd just read. When I was here last, there was another book that had come out not too long before that, and I read from that. And this one is a new. It's a select poem, so it goes across what I've done over time, but I thought I'd just read some, and it has new poems in it as well, so I thought I'd just read some from the later stuff, because I've read the other things, and I've read here, quite, not here in the bookshop, but here in Vassar, obviously, from time to time as well. So, I'd read more recent stuff, grimmer stuff, maybe. Usually I'm so lighthearted. This stuff seems a little on the grimmer side, but some of it does. I would start with a poem that actually Rachel and I have a small place across in the west of Ireland, on Connemara and the coast there. And when I ever go back, as I go back whenever I can, but in summers usually, and when Vassar was kind enough to give me leaves, then some of them are spent there too. But there was always that kind of lift into a place. You know, you have places, you are given places, you choose places. Vassar, you know, I've been here, Poughkeepsie, for 35 years now. And that was accidental in some ways. And yet it was a choice. You're born in one place, and then you choose other places. And this was one of them. But place in Ireland, which is out on the west coast, I was born in Dublin, I'm from Dublin, and I need a watch, because otherwise we're here at midnight, right? Just as soon as I get going, I won't stop. But I know I'd read for about 45 minutes, and bear it. Anyway, this is a small place in the west of Ireland, and when I go back there, I've been going there now since the 70s. Since around the time I started writing poetry, some seriousness. But there's always that kind of little lift, and this is just a little poem suggesting that that's happening. And I mentioned a couple of things that I just mentioned here. I say there's a lot of cottages around, ruined cottages, which are presumably remnants of famine history. And I also mentioned a pheasant, which a very gaudy bird in a very stony place. And it too, like me, is a kind of blow-in, although it came in the 17th century, and I came a little later than that. Place. First morning back, there's a faint cap of cloud on the brow of Tully Mountain. Flash of a blackbird between sycamore and ash, glint of dew on a few daisies the side has spared. Lilies of the valley stand in a battered can. The cover of my mother's prayer book wrinkles with light, and my neighbor's rickety mutt mumbles a crust of stale bread. In early sunshine, the houses across the lake seem solid as chateaus, seem as if they'd stand forever. High arched, their barns are granaries of light, though the old cottages lie like bones over the open fields. And here, slightly apologetic, comes the cough of the cock pheasant, stepping among potato drills as if he owned the place. Crimson and cinnabar his head, his feathers cinnamon and gold. He will hide in his own life down there, where whins and heather and boggy grass can flourish, and the sunny morning be sheer heaven to him. I should have said whins are gorse bushes, great flashes of yellow and horny green. I'll come back to this part of the world, I think, in this poem, and it's kind of a wintry poem. I thought I'd begin more or less. You can, if anyone who's interested in looking at my work, you can see if I'm writing about summer or something, it's generally over there. If I'm writing about winter, it's generally here. And I don't think that's mood necessarily. This actually does take place here. And it's a little poem. This book is called Out of Breath, and it's called Out of Sight. I had another book called Out of Breath. Oddly enough, I'm running out of things to get out of. What's next? Out of mind. But anyway, this one is called Breath, and it's kind of just looking out the window back there in On Wing Road. And thinking about some of the stuff around and about. Breath. Small pause in leaf matter. Smell of resin and balsam filling me for a minute before I go. All that's alive in this necropolis of wanwood and wood chip is the scent of what was locked deep in leaf vein and the grain of things, when the woods were walked through and see about, where now two squirrels swirl skittering up peeled tree bark. To stop in the middle of it all, the afternoon light informing each crevice of bark, each filament in the squirrel's tail, or gilding every mint green smear of lichen, or falling like a tongue of fire on a sky blue plastic canister, is to stand inside the pharmacopoeia of aromas exhaled by mounds of rot. Their airy, liberated nothings become something like that evidence of the world which I saw this morning in the small bursts of breath smoke out of a blue jay's mouth, the sign of the sound of him standing on the feeder to make his own annunciation to the earth he's the present epicenter of, and to me halted on its rim, hardly breathing. I was looking for a poem that had autumn in it, and this one has. It's not actually here. Well, it is here, but it's also at home in Ireland. And it's also a poem I decided I'd read because of the goodies on the table there. All those bits of bread, all those soda breads, and God knows what. Huge loaf, actually, of it. So this is called... I'm from Dublin, like I said, and I've lived here. And so the poem is actually called Dublin-Poughkeepsie, Bread Knife in Exile. And the reason for the title is I got two heirlooms from my parents, as far as I remember. One was a salt cellar, and the other was a bread knife. I mean, they didn't leave me then in some will or other. Those are the things I took when I could. And they're interesting things because they, like Proust, the Proustian thing of the object, in his case, the Madeleine, you know, you look at the soul seller and it pops my mother, basically, I do. And the bread knife is the same thing. And I listened to the bread knife, it's later than I wrote about the soul seller one time. And the bread knife, when you, if it, it's very tiny, little teeth. And if you rub it through, if you push it through bread, of course, it kind of sinks. So I rarely use the word exile. That's not what I am. I'm a migrant, if anything. But it's in this poem. Dublin to Poughkeepsie, bread knife and exile. Home from home again. The song of my mother's bread knife stops me mid-slice. Teeth of Sheffield steel making their own music. That had cut through the cackle and half-truths of our first kitchen, as she'd sever the black crust of an elbow turnover, or slice into the burnt brown of the Vienna roll, she'd slather with country butter, its salty sweat, making our mouths water, where we stood in the light of the world as was, that has become the here and now of the world as is. A few streaks of sunlight bringing in fall flicker and stipple shadows, leaves turning amber, ginger, rust, as the season beyond the window turns. And I settle a migrant heart again in this other where, hearing the persistent, shrill stitching of one late September cricket, which my mother, though only a ghost, cocks her one good ear to, stopping the bread knife mid-slice to listen, stunned to silence first, then turning to ask me what that strange insect singing is. But before I can answer, she's smiling anyway, saying yes in her old way to it, to what's becoming, foreign as it is, familiar as the music her bone-handled bread knife goes on making, which long ago now and far away, she stopped noticing. I'm going to read a wintry poem that has the Vassar campus as a starring role in it. It's actually, it gives away the fact that I'm a bit of a voyeur, which I suppose is fair enough. But I remember a few winters ago looking out the window of the library over there, and everybody is huddled and walking fast. It was very cold, and it was probably February, and awful February. But there was a young couple, a young man, a young woman, and they were hugging one another. And so they just stood there in the middle of the freeze, people rushing by them, and they hugged one another. So, and I, in my role as Satan in the Garden of Eden, was checking them out. Anyway, from that. Reading to your friends and to colleagues and students, of course, like this, it's a bit like taking your clothes off in public. I'd only do a little of that. It's called Opposing Forces. Even in this sharp weather, there are lovers everywhere, holding on to each other, hands in one another's pockets for warmth, for the sense of I'm yours, the tender claim it keeps making. One couple stopping in the chill to stand there, faces pressed together, arms around jacketed shoulders, so I can see her bare hands grapple with padding, see the rosy redness of cold fingers as they shift a little, trying to register through fold after fold. This is my flesh feeling you, your feeling. It must be some contrary instinct in the blood that sets itself against the weather like this, brings lovers out like early buds, like the silver-gray catkins I saw this morning polished to brightness by ice overnight. Geese too, more and more couples voyaging north, great high-spirited congregations taking the freezing air in and letting it out as song, as if this frigid enterprise were all joy, nothing to be afraid of. And I've written these things down funnily. They're not in order, so I have to keep looking to see what's what. Okay, this is a little one that again shifts back. I mean, I've lived between two places. I've lived in two places ever since, you know, the 1960s. And I think that's certainly affected what I do. And in some ways, it affects not only what I do in terms of subject matter, but I think it also affects it in terms of just in terms of consciousness, in the way of kind of hovering between. Even titles I use tend to hover between meanings. You know, what does that actually mean, matter of fact? Or what does so it goes actually mean? That kind of stuff. Anyway, this one is a poem that takes place back there, back in Ireland. And it's one of those new things. Let me see. It has a couple of references to painters. Chardin, you know, I love those great, still lifes, those great still lifes on their little altar of hares and pheasants and all kinds of birds and shot game and so on. They're fantastic. And then there's Chaim Soutine, who does very slightly weird stuff too, in the original. So they just get mentioned here. And it's just a kind of little inventory of things I saw on a walk. And it's called Quick. Quick. When I saw the rainbow shine to life from the flank of Letter Hill, and stand like a ladder of magic and hang there half-formed, and beheld the wren fussing among fuchsia twigs in fierce pursuit of flies, and snapping at every shadow, I thought I'd been blessed enough by quickness and color for one morning. Till I stumbled across the dead hare, one quick thing stilled where the car had hit, and left it as Chardin might have offered it up to us, or Chaim Soutine have laid it naked to our gaze in its slicked back, blood-spotted brown coat, its back legs acutely angled, a dash of white under each front paw, one clouded grey eye open on nothing, in the infinite depths of which that rainbow reflected itself for a few minutes maybe, with maybe the occasional bird shade flashing on a blank canvas of blue before, in a flash, vanishing. Okay, a lot of the poems, I think, in the last book I did and then in these new poems, a lot just vary between, you know, things that are there and things that are gone. This kind of fleetingness. So that's what inflects that particular one. I also, when I was writing these pieces, which were written mainly in 2006, I think, these new ones, I was struck by my living in peace and in the small little space I was. And then what was going on in the wider world, which of course was horrible stuff. I think the shelling of Gaza was going on that time, and of course, as usual, there were lots of other bad stuff going on. Mainly far away from here, and certainly far away from where I live in the west of Ireland, which is a very peaceful little corner, except for the weather, of the world. Yes. This is called World As Is. Between the old stone, I should say that beside us, beside where Rachel and I are, there's a kind of house, and on top of it is it's a ruin, you know, but part of it looks like a man sitting on a chair on top. It must have been a bit of the chimney or something, you know, so it's a curious sight, and whenever I see it, you all say, "Oh, you're all slightly surprised." So he gets in here, or he gets in. World As Is. Between the old stone man in his limestone greatcoat and the small white house on the hill, between pale green waves and the high notes of the plovers as they arrow away from the strand and my solid figure striding there, between the foal sheltering under his mother's flank from the slanting rain, and the blackbird at dusk singing and bringing the fixed stars out. lies what bond, I wonder, as I trudge head down, bent into the protection of hedges? What delicate machine makes its presence felt in the world of spent tabernacles and rattled nerves we inhabit? Or is it something in the nature of the evanescent symmetries, lest this be, that has banged against my window and jackhammered there in raging indignation at the irreversible logic of the fact of glass, be scooped into the soft dark of the napkin I've wrapped it in, through which I can feel what we would call its anger, its despair, still quick to the end it must sense has happened, till I open the cloth outside, and after a second or two of stillness as daylight envelops it again, it lights out and floats off in the free air. At one again, with what makes simple sense to it, the world as is, in their exquisite, absolute, inexpressible balance. Work to be done, direction chosen. Anything can happen. This one is, it's even more specific about a certain kind of violence and my feeling. I was looking at horses. You know, I felt what if a missile just dropped there? And it was again during when there was all sorts of news on the radio. And this is called After the 1 o'clock news. It would take very little, wouldn't it, to take that horse in the field across the road. That mare not wayward at all, but tranquil, in the wind wavering domesticity of grass. Her flank quartz white, nuzzled by her coffee colored foal. The two deftly, attentively grooming each other. Take so little in the shape of a blunt gun, or even a wayward missile, landing near my neighbor's shed, to take the two of them, mother and child, to the end and way beyond the end of their invisible tether. Remove them from the loop of daily life in a flash of hot light, a thunder crash, a blood sudden, thick pink mist, and then nothing. Nothing but the riven piece of Letter Hill echoing what happened, and a drift of blue-black smoke curling on the cool breeze across this roof I've tucked myself under, and floating off over the bay of Ballinakil, to be sighted near Derry Inver Pier as an indecipherable sign of something seen from far out at sea, or from the cosy homesteads of Achill, Inish Turk, or Inish Boffin. One of the other things, one of the other notes I tend to play or have always played, I guess, and that's what you have a look at a book that says new and selected poems on it, and you think, and you read through and you say, well, there's that note again, and you say, oh dear, or you say, oh well, that's interesting, that's kind of, it means you're consistent, or it means you're boringly repetitive, I don't know which, but I do write quite often, and or have written quite often, particularly in their growing up, in which they were, you know, close to me, and close to Joan, and then close to me and Rachel. I wrote quite a lot about the kids, and they're in their liminal moments, their moments of passage, whether they were very young, going to school for the first time, or whether much older, leaving home in one way or another. And this one has some of that in it. And it concerns Rachel and my Kira. And again, it takes place at a station, so it's one of those threshold places, I suppose. Parents and departing train. For all the wavering truth of trees reflected in rainwater, or the undulant disappearing bulk of the white-tailed deer into the deer-colored dusk of the apple orchard, its raised tail a pennant of life on the run, its pure white glimmer candle gone as soon as seen. For all that I believe of transience, each moment murdered by the next one, each breath dying into its twin, it still seems impossible to find the right language for how our daughter shoulders her heavy bags and boards the train and is taken from us. Just a shadow of a shadow kissing its fingers at where our shadows stand outside. Me settling an arm around your shoulders, your pale face and hair nearly ghostly in the air, that otherwise all gold, saffron, burgundy, rust, as our girl, speedy as any express, is taken into the distance her own life is now, a place beyond lullaby or open-eyed angel, a nameless space we keep peering into for that sheer glimmer, girl-shaped, flickering into dusk. I guess it's sometimes useful for the children to know that you actually keep an eye on them in a kind of very distinctive way, because they think it's just part of the friend you have. No, they don't. Mine don't. This is actually about it's a bit of a poem. Maybe I'll read the whole poem. It's not that big. It has my son, our son Connor, in it. Yeah, it's a three-part poem, and I'll read it all because. He set off and he went around the world and so on, and he was around 30, I suppose, after he finished working for a long time over in Europe. Connor did, and then he ended up in Nepal, where he established an orphanage eventually and an NGO, and eventually then he headed off up into the mountains to find the families of his of some of his orphans, and he found happily them all. But when he was gone for about 3 weeks, having left note that if he wasn't back by X, his parents should be informed that he was stuck on the border of Tibet, kind of thing, in the mountains, because this is a place without wheels and without glass or anything, this place he was in. Nonetheless, he did get back, but during all that time, I was very frightened, basically, and it turned out for good reason. That was the place where the Maoists had taken control, and then there was the ceasefire, and that's when he went in. But so I wrote a few poems, and this is a little triad of poems from that. I'll read them all. It's called On Edge, and it has little subtitles. And the first one is called Because. Because the man on the train seat in front of me wears a black trilby and is playing very softly a tenor sax, his body shape swaying in the dark mirror of the window. Because the day has, without my noticing, entered suddenly into the tunnel of night, so the lights we pass are doubled in the dream trouble of the river. Because that bright-lit path floating in the dark is a bridge solid stepping across water. Because I'm caught like this, speechless, almost thoughtless, empty of everything except the flicker of what passes. Because it's hard to stay afloat. Because the old style of faith and hope has been extinguished. So it's difficult to find a point to pray to or wish on. And because I'm hearing in the clatter and shake of train wheels the rattle tune riff of the bare forked animal, I can do nothing except direct this pulsing of the hapless heart to the other half of the world, where a young man is setting off high on hope into the unknown, his good heart beating with the lovely risk of it, the mission alive in his mind, and seeing, let be, the end of it, the found families around him, all the lost kids recovered, and he so far from home. And the second one, in the same, is called Words. Hard to be in a state where the simple words father, son, child cause something at the base of the throat to heat up, cause a stammer to happen in the right eyelid, some out of control ticking in the nerves to register their dismay, their disarray. So I won't think of what's in the nature of things out there, up there in rock and ice and snow, out there in the high places, out there among the nameless deities, who, being so far off, may not be prayed to. But scraping away on this tuneless fiddle, I find it strange how a story of bird fights staining snow scarlet distracts me. The blind and deaf blackcocks going at it in their short, ferocious now or never. Blood pooling their eyes so nothing at all can be known except the sharpness of life happening, happening as one foot and then the booted other, of those trekkers among the high places where no roads are, keep measuring the way, keep beating time to their return journey, their comeback to where they started, which is when I'll start breathing again, knowing father, son, child, as words to melt in my mouth again, not this chill now stinging it. And this other one is called Soul Stuff in Flight. Watching the propeller of this cumbersome blunt-nosed object rev and spin, become invisible, but for a faint circle inscribed on air, a sort of shadow of the speed of light, you wonder, could this be an image of the soul? The speedy reel, becoming nothing but the driving force itself and what follows. The way we know when we move at last, it's there, but where? We're airborne then, and under us spread the square green fields of Galway, then the rest of Ireland over in no time, and we're above the slow, grey rising of the Irish Sea. Then the green and pleasant ploughlands of England are coming up to meet us, sheer speed bearing our load, all the way to where, on a surprise street in West Hampstead, your son runs up to greet you, a soul in flight, and finds your shoulders with his two arms, your two cheeks astonished with his kisses. So, let's see, this is a poem. This is a poem that has. Let me figure out how much time. I guess I read faster than I thought. Anyway, this is a poem that has a Turkish poet as its patron, I suppose you could say, insofar as I quote him a couple of bits in it. A man called, a poet called Nazim Hikmet, great poet, and a poet put in prison for his political views. Spent a long time in prison, actually, during which time he wrote to his wife these letters. And so I quoted from this the letters. And I just use him in some ways to meditate on something. The poem is called Ready, and it has a epigraph from Hikmet, which says, standing motionless in the midst of infinity. Ready. It's a skinny horse he's describing, a crippled nag outside his cell window, while he writes another letter to his wife. I can see it in the stillness too, in this grey Connemara mare, whose head droops a little, simply being there, while her foal stares at me over the hedge, the mother in that moment being the center of a world without borders. In a second so dense with mere being, it throws time into meltdown, and I join the animal in it for a timeless minute before coming to myself again and walking on with a head full of Hikmet in prison, who's telling his wife how he faces into silence by singing in the thin piping voice of my childhood, and how in spring he's led out to sunshine for the first time and stands animal-like, motionless in wonder, and stays emptied out like that and happy, his back against the wall, like the birds I've seen standing stilled for minutes at a time in the shelter of hedges and staring out without moving a feather, eyes full of nothing but emptiness, entranced in every sense, it seems, by the feel of just being there, the sense of being anything at all, or nothing, with no fixed abode but the body. Like a sail, says Hikmet, ready for the journey. So it's that kind of meditative condition, you know, that I think art is after some of the time. I don't think some poetry is after it, certainly, but I think all art is after that meditative, you know, that kind of condition of readiness and attention that can bring you anywhere, I suppose, maybe. I'm going to read a prose thing now that has my students here in it, since there are lots of students here, there's some students here, and the I have to look for the it's a 9/11. I mean, you know, 9/11 happened, and you're stunned, you're silenced, and so that's true. I wrote a bit after it, but I wrote prose. I wrote bits of prose, prose poems, those kind of things in which you don't have any lines to orchestrate your movement and your music. You just have sentences, and so. But it didn't seem to me I could write anything about about 9/11. Obviously, it defeats speech. Certain kind of catastrophes defeat speech, I think. So that's the point. I mean, and then that's the subject. There's a great moment in Macbeth where a Scottish play for the theatre people, right? in which Macduff is told about the deaths of his children and his wife and all my pretty ones in one fell swoop, you know. And it's obvious, I used to love with my students giving them a sense of what stage directions are kind of built into the text itself. Because it's clear from what somebody says to him. Somebody says to him, "What man, ne'er pull your hat about your brows." And it's clear, therefore, when Shakespeare's actor is doing whatever he's doing, he certainly turns away and puts his hat. First of all, he must be wearing a hat. And second of all, he pulls it down over his face and he stays quiet. And the king, so to be Malcolm and the other guy, Lennox or somebody, try to get him to speak. And he says, answer it like a man or something. I can't remember what that verb is. But he then says, but first I must feel it like a man. Ooh. And they say dispute it like a man. He said, but first I must feel it like a man. And that's silence. It must be one of the great moments in Shakespeare, really, of silence on the stage. Don't get too many. Total silence. And then it's about speech and disaster. Anyway. We were doing Macbeth at the time when we heard this bad news. And this is one of two parts, but I'll just read the second part. And it's the title of the poem is "What Happened," and the title of the little subtitle of this part is "Afterward, the teacher thinks about his students. All they want is adequate speech. So we reach across the great plains of the classroom table, tripping over our words. It will never be enough. Eyes of the lost, tears where one is looking at me, trying to speak. What man? Now pull your hat about your brows. When I draw down the blinds, the sky of rubble and smoke is swept away to nothing, a blank. I know this script. It beggars translation. Dispute it like a man. Syllable by syllable, the story is coming out of red headbands, box cutters, plastic knives. A book of simple instructions. Barking and bark lovingly, yes, at one another. First this, then that, then the other, and we are, praise heaven, whole. Poor eyes drowning and no one to ask. Please is my name on your list, it is my father, no, is there another list? The book is passed from hand to hand to hand. It falls open as smoke. It hurts to squint through it, a grievous affliction, to imagine we might loosen our tongues, that we might go on. They've gone home now, hungry as field mice in February, in silence, not one crumb of comfort among them. And more. I'll read this one. Which is called Touch. It removes itself from the political into the more or less erotic, but also the avian into the birds zone. Rachel, who's not here, I told her I would read a couple of these poems. She said, well, all right. So, this one's called Touch. Surely it's for the comfort of touch, just as we two through the night let our sleeping hands rest along each other's flesh, warming them, that these two ruffle-winged, orange-breasted robins nudge each other through air above a dead bough birch before settling all skittery life among rotted branches, then steady themselves to preen and look about for maybe a minute, then take off, lighting out one after the other into that wide aloneness that has to be their normal life, flying from sight, separate, but heading in the same direction, traversing, says Traherne, the regions of air. Every wing beat, a quick tilting, intimate adjustment to the necessary perfection of flight. Just as our sleeping hands take stock of how our bodies shift through the small hours, adjusting to whatever in the touch and go of time and circumstance passes for perfection in the way of two being simply together. Just as this pair of robins simply part the air between them in their above earth hurry, each alone, attending, knowing the other there. Love poems come out in curious angles, I suppose. I'll do a couple more and that stuff. This is a poem called, it's the first poem in the new poems. It's my own little attempt at a kind of still life. I love still lives. I love their organization of the world and their capacity to understand the object and bring it so close to us. And then I also love Caravaggio, who is, you know, Min and I know, you know, the great poet of a certain kind of light, obviously, and doing something at an angle. There's one great picture of Caravaggio's painting in which Christ is calling Matthew, I guess, and it's a great shaft of light from the window into Matthew, and Christ is in the shadow. I'm not going to do much, I just mention it, because it's a tiny wee poem, but my mention of the Caravaggio was what I thought about the way small pieces of data are luminously foregrounded by shafts of light, and a lot of the stuff I've done has a kind of connection with that fact, and so a fair amount, witness the other poem about the young ones out in the yard there, out in the camps. A certain amount of poems I do too have their position is at a window, and a window, of course, is its own kind of painting, I suppose. Anyway. This thing is called, believe it or not, window. Sleek blades of rain. Through the window, wind-shriven fuchsia twigs won't stop shivering. Light, its escalations and retreats. Quickened limb shapes fling themselves into the willing curtains. A naked lemon, waxy skin gleam, leading its coruscating bitter life on the window ledge. And one orange lighting up my writing table, resurrected like a single square inch of a Caravaggio by the sudden sun shaft calling it to awe, half its incandescent, sweet-stocked glow in shadow. That's the first of these new poems, and I'll read the last of them, and then I'll read two more poems. Two other poems. Okay, this would be the last poem, and I ended it because the first poem I wrote here, the first poem I have here, is me sitting at a window, checking things out among the gulls in Ireland, in West, or in Ballymoney, in east of Ireland. This one has me walking, and I thought, all right, I began sitting down, looking out, but in this one I'm walking. I'm actually out there among things. And what I'm doing is just walking on the Strand nearby where we live out in the west of Ireland. and there's nothing really about it except the mountain, big mountain there. I will never call an Irish hill a mountain again, having just come back from Colorado. No point, really, right? I looked out my window when I was in Colorado Springs for a month, or 4 weeks there, and there, like almost literally across the road, is a 14,000 foot peak called Pike's Peak. I thought, right, there it is. Now. But we call Milrea Mountain. It's the highest mountain in the west of Ireland. So, another poor thing. So that gets mentioned in here. That's all. From this to that. Stepping overboard from the dream-laden vessel of sleep, its cargo of foreign tongues, sun-split stones of Italy, one coloured bundle of kindlewood, and the music of God knows who, played on the French horn by the poet's only daughter. You walk a while by the actual tideline, the ocean drawn back to expose sea rocks colonized by purple-painted tribes of young mussels, where three oyster catchers grown hysterical at the frightful sight of you leave their lethal business among mollusks to flap flee over the waves in baffling black, white, white, black Escher flashes. You attend then to the lime green toupees of weed near the near rocks wear. Take in the shoreline glint of scabious and coltsfoot, the quick ignitions of a few leftover leaves of pink thrift. See one short-masted black trawler riding the waves, and spot the head and periscope neck of a cormorant as it vanishes between breaths, reappears, and looks about as if surprised to find the world as is. Sky, sea, the rugged bulk of Muilre, keeping one from the other. As you yourself look about, minding the seabird's amphibian gift to live underwater and in air, to stand on its isolate perch in the wingspread very image of a black phoenix rising. Stumble on so, to true wakefulness, all dreams dissipated, and stop silenced on a seal-smooth rock half buried in sand, knowing nothing but the burden of what you've seen, pondering the simple, specific gravity of it, the jag line leading from this to that, before you turn for home. And just two poems I'll end with. The first of them is a home domestic poem, but it's also about clematis, you know, the plant clematis. I love that plant, and now our one finally died. But you see it, and it's just sticks, and then you see it again, and it's a burst of blossom. But you really think it's dead. I certainly have always thought it was dead, and then it always surprised me, because it ain't. It has an extraordinary possibility, and that became a kind of motif for me as I watched it. And then there were other things that come in here, and you can hear what they are. And the poem is dedicated to Rachel, but it also takes, because you know, it's about the garden, and it's about her father is in it too, and so is his granddaughter, her daughter, so when she was much younger. The search. It's the sheer tenacity of the clematis clinging to rusty wire and chipped wood fence that puts this sky blue flare and purple fire in its petals. To be new in autumn, in mid-September, to be showing yourself like that, naked as water under full moonlight. Something has to be good in such a world, in the talent it has for lasting and coming back, in the way it decorates our graves, our standing walls, our back porches, and in the way the late bee lands on its dazzle, walks the circumference of every petal in some minor key of astonishment, drinking the last of its sapphire wine. What takes shape is a cellular sense of how the moment is jammed to splitting with excess, each pod and sweet kernel plumped to bursting with the brash simplicities of contradiction. The child's tears watering the plant that seems from a shrivel of bones to make itself an azure conflagration, seeming to say, there's always more to say. Language can be like that, taking its stand on the driest, most barren space of clay, asking only that we attend, behold a being no more than being itself, and nothing blooming. And tonight, the old man, your father, smiled twice. Once when he'd reached the sofa after the 50-mile shuttle from the hall door. Once when his tongue tasted the tart cool of a spoonful of blueberries, and he turned his eyes, shining their milky blue, on the child, who lifted her brimming spoon and smiled back at him. Now, I'll end with this. It's a poem that has Yeats in it, so I thought maybe it's appropriate, particularly since I see a member of the audience to whom I taught Yeats back in 1972, three, four, just before I got here, who is now a teacher of Yeats himself. So this one's for you, Ted. Well, it's for all students yet. But Yeats said a few strange things, and of course lots of great things too. One of the things he says, and it always sort of startled me, he had a funny thing about breakfast. He said, and there's an epigraph, the poem is called In the Kitchen with Yeats. Some of you may have heard me read it before, I hadn't read it before. But he said in the epigraph to this, a poet never speaks directly as to someone at the breakfast table. Even when he seems most himself, he is never the bundle of accident and incoherence that sits down to breakfast. I thought, whoa, Yeats and breakfast must have been a queer sight, as they say. But I didn't get him to breakfast. I thought I might sometime. But I did get him to the kitchen, or as far as the kitchen. Now, you also remember, it's a great, great Yeats poem called the Wild Swans Are Cool. The trees are in their autumn beauty, and the woodland paths are dry, you know, and under the October twilight, the water mirrors a still sky. Upon the brimming water among the stones are 950 swans. Well, Yeats wrote that poem very shortly after having proposed for the umpteenth time to Maud Gonne, who for the umpteenth time said, sorry, Willie, no go, it would be a bad, bad idea. And Yeats then decided, undaunted, he was in his 50s, 1917, I think, to ask her daughter to marry him. And Isolde Gonne also had the wit to say no as well, I suppose. But then Yeats went out and checked out the swans, basically, and wrote this poem. It's a great poem, and I encourage you to read it if you haven't read it. One of the odd things about it is actually, and I noted this when I was kind of writing this probably, was it has a missing rhyme in each stanza. So there's a lot, there's 59 swans, and there's a missing rhyme. There's a lot of, you know, that stuff. It doesn't matter, that's just the my academic self. It feeds the poem a little bit. In the Kitchen with Yeats, the poet never speaks directly as to someone at the breakfast table. Even when he seems most himself, he's never the bundle of accident and incoherence that sits down to breakfast. Since the poet is never the man that sits down to breakfast, never that bundle of bits and pieces, but the composed whole bloke, buzzing iambics behind a closed door, I suppose he wasn't one to linger if ever he visited the kitchen, his sense of smell confined to incense, honey, wine, and other emblematic fragrances. So what would he make of me in this cottage kitchen on his birthday, stirring a sauce for pasta, one hand holding a wooden spoon, the other his collected poems, a fresh edition. With one ear I listen to the homely little splutter of tomatoes, spices, garlic, and diced onion as they bubble towards their unity of being, while with the other I can hear the clear, austere music of the wild swans at cool, the ache of its defeats beating through that one lost rhyme each stanza, and through those clean lifelines of his that keep cheating us out of ease, but lead to grace. Wooden spoon tapping the skillet, I close my eyes to get the poem by heart, making its cold, companionable manners my own as long as that music lasts, while all the while the cottage fills to steamy brimming with smells that distill into the air some vegetarian notion of the soul, and fills with the ceremony of sound he stirred into the stock of his own marrowbone soup to keep us, even in lean times, warm. Now, when I close the book and leave the sauce to simmer, the whole place breathes a single compound smell of garlic, tomatoes, onions, oregano, pepper, cinnamon, wild thyme, all in a base of olive oil and crowned with a leaf or two of bay. Later, wondering how he might have relished the scent of his own ascending dinner, winding up the winding stairs, I'll spoon the wine dark mixture over fettuccine, sprinkle parmesan, aged 9 months, prop up his book against the bowl, and eat. Thank you. Read it.
Would you mind?
Oh yeah, sure.
It's page 16.
All right. Well, she's the organizer.
Thank you.
And I didn't say at the beginning, thanks Susan for it. And of course, thanks everybody for coming. But I think what you do here gives such vitality to the to the bookshop, which you wouldn't otherwise have, it seems to me, without that kind of engagement and that kind of putting a lot of time into it, I must say, and browbeating people like me to come and do the reading. And we're only too willing, obviously. But it's great. You create a kind of stage for new work, and for people to get in touch with readers, basically. I mean, people who actually could like their work, or people who are curious and could be introduced to it. So I think it's a great way to use our bookshop. I mean, the bookshop that is part of our community in a very positive way. So thanks for that, and for you, therefore, for the record. I won't even ask you why you like this poem, but it was the last poem, as far as I remember. It was in the first book I did back in 1983. And again, the locale is that landscape of Ireland. And just garden there, and as you know, Ireland pretty wet. In fact, they're having 70 miles an hour winds at this moment out there. So I've heard on the radio. Anyway, for the record, after 6 unsparing days of storm, a grey still day without rain. Nothing spectacular, no exploding stars off the lake, no precious glitter of soaked grass, no triumph in bannering branches, just branches, taking the air as if it belonged to them, the faint, sleepy chink, chink of the robin in the next field, and everything back in its place. But nothing carnival or sabbatical, only a steady domestic peace secures all animations in the garden, giving everything its due. No fuss, no unexpected flares, no amazing grace in the play and swift transfigurings of light or water. Only cloud, seamless, still air, this hush. So, after 6 days of storm, record a perfectly ordinary day at last. Dry, a little on the cool side. Thanks again.
A picture of our audience. Who has a camera? We need to get this. Somebody. I'm serious. But anyway, please stay. We have punch. We have more punch. And we have 2 soda breads. Very important announcement. 1 soda bread is blessed, and 1 is not. So please take your chances. I'm not telling you which one. And we have Eamon's book, and please stay. Thank you. And come back. We have other